start our morning worship today with an opening prayer, and we all join together, raise our voices to the Almighty. Our Father, help us to worship you in spirit and in truth, that our consciences may be quickened by your holiness, our minds nourished by your truth, our imaginations purified by your beauty, our hearts opened by your love, our wills surrendered to your purpose, and may all this be gathered up in adoration as we ascribe glory, praise, and honor to you alone, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our psalm this morning is Psalm 105, verses 1 to 7. Give praise to the Lord, proclaim his name. Make known among the nations what he has done. Sing to him, sing praises to him. Tell of all his wonderful acts. Glory in his name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Look to the Lord and his strength, and seek his face always. Remember the wonders he has done, his miracles, and the judgments he pronounced. You, his servants, the descendants of Abraham, his chosen ones, the children of Jacob. He is the Lord our God. His judgments are in all the earth. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. We join together in the prayer of preparation. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Have our first song, Glorious Things of Thee Are Spoken.
Thank you.
will sin. We deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just, and will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us therefore confess together. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father,
we have sinned against you and one another, in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have left undone. We are sorry and repent of all our sins. For your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name.
May Almighty God have mercy upon us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our collect for today. Merciful God, your Son came to save us and bore our sins on the cross. May we trust in your mercy and know your love, rejoicing in the righteousness that is ours, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We now have the reading by Glennis.
This morning's reading is taken from Philippians chapter 1, verse 21 to the end. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I am to go on living in the body, this will mean fruitful labor for me. Yet what shall I choose? I do not know. I am torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far. But it is more necessary for you that I remain in the body. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain, and I will continue with all of you for your progress and joy in the faith, so that through my being with you again, your boasting in Christ Jesus will abound on account of me. Whatever happens, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. Then, whether I come and see you or only hear about you in my absence, I will know that you stand firm in the one Spirit, striving together as one for the faith of the gospel, without being frightened in any way by those who oppose you. This is a sign to them that they will be destroyed, but that you will be saved, and that by God. For it has been granted to you on behalf of Christ, not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for him, since you are going through the same struggle you saw I had, and now hear that I still have. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. We now have our next song, which is Great is Thy Faithfulness, O God, my Father.
Thank you.
parable of the workers in the vineyard. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire workers for his vineyard. He agreed to pay them a denarius for the day and sent them into his vineyard. About 9 in the morning, he went out and saw others standing in the marketplace, doing nothing. He told them, "You also go and work in my vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. He again went out about noon and about 3 in the afternoon and did the same thing. About 5 in the afternoon, he went out and found still others standing around. He asked them, "Why have you been standing here all day, doing nothing?" "Because no one has hired us," they answered. He said to them, "You also go and work in my vineyard." When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, "Call the workers and pay them their wages, who were, beginning with the last ones hired and going to the first." The workers who were hired about 5 in the afternoon came and each received a denarius. So when those came who were first hired first, they expected to receive more. But each one of them also received a denarius. When they received it, they began to grumble against the landowner. "These who were hired last worked only 1 hour," they said, "and you have made them equal to us, who have borne the burden of the work and the heat of the day." But he answered one of them, "I am not being unfair to you, my friend. Didn't you agree to work for a denarius? Take your pay and go. I want to give the one who was hired last the same as I gave you. Don't I have the right to do what I want with my own money? Or are you envious because I am generous? So the last will be first, and the first will be last." This is the gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, O Lord.
May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in the sight of God, our strength and our Redeemer.
Amen.
I'd like to start the sermon with a fun and fictitious story, but of real significance, which we will note at the end of the sermon. Now, a story is told of a man who died and went to heaven. St. Peter met him at the pearly gates and asked to examine his qualifications. "We have a point system here," St. Peter said, "and only those with enough points are allowed to enter." "Points?" the man said. "I don't know what you're talking about." St. Peter explained. "It's simple. We determine how many points you have by the life you've led. We require 100 points to get in. Tell me about your life, and I'll add up your points." The man thought for a moment and said, "Well, let's see. I was a faithful member of my church for over 47 years. served as a deacon and an elder. I taught Sunday school. St. Peter said, very good, very good. You get 1 point. The man said to himself, oh my, well, let's see. I was a good husband. I was a good father. I gave a tithe to the church, and I contributed to all sorts of charities. I helped with various civic projects, and I served on several committees. Doesn't that count for anything? St. Peter said, indeed it does. You get another point. The man's face sank, and he said, I can see now I'll never make it. The only way I'll ever get into this place called heaven is by the grace of God. St. Peter smiled and said, and that, my friend, is worth 98 points. Welcome. Joking aside, we cannot glibly dismiss this parable and put it on the shelf and marked Bible passage not to be taken seriously. There are many, many lessons to be gleaned by carefully considering this parable of the laborers in the vineyard. This, my friends, is a battle between our will and God's will, or human thinking and God's marvelous grace. As we note, it is taken from Matthew 20, verse 1 to verse 16. And it's very interesting, and one that is very well known. We see a generous landowner who hired men to work for him at various times throughout the day and paid them all the same wages. This caused contention between the workers who started at the beginning of the day and the landowner. In the words of one of my grandsons when he was younger, that's not fair. But that's how we think. Things must fit our idea of fairness. And when it comes to works, if we do more, we expect to get more. But when we look at the Bible, does God reward works which are never perfect, or trust and faith in Him? Can I suggest that God rewards trust in Him over works? He looks for those who study His ways and not simply study works. This is an important point that Jesus brings out with this parable. God's way is to reward all those who trust in Him and let Him decide what the reward will be. We should not run away with the idea, however, that God treats everyone the same, but He decides when differences are to be made. He decides. God is both fair and full of grace. The thing that is without the Holy Spirit in us, our thoughts are not His thoughts. And as a result of our carnal state, we apply the criteria of fairness in the situations when we should apply grace. And we can think grace will apply when the godly person should be fair. If we look at the parables, we will see that God is always right, always full of grace, and always fair in the required situation. Fairness and grace. He did not have to give anything. We hope that Holy Spirit will guide our thinking processes and our thoughts will become aligned with God's thoughts. So, what was it about those workers who worked all day that made them so angry when the others got paid the same? The first problem was the fact that they were obviously working for the pay and not out of a sense of pleasure or purpose. So, we ask the question, what is it that motivates you or I to do what we do? Whether you're employed full-time or serve as a volunteer, whether you work in the community or around the house, what motivates you to do what you do? If it's money or recognition or the praise of others, be careful. Be very careful. For most jobs don't even pay enough to satisfy a healthy ego. If what you're doing isn't self-satisfying and self-fulfilling, you're likely, I say likely, you may not, harbor resentment and anger about doing it. And when someone comes along doing the same job, getting the same pay, you're likely to feel resentful, as the workers in the parable. Only as you truly enjoy what you're doing will you have the right motivation and continue God's work. If the workers who worked all day and had this attitude about their work, they wouldn't have resented those who only got to work 1 hour. When you're in the right vocation and you've got the right spirit, then you no longer work for others, but you work for God. And God's justice arises out of a gracious invitation to use your innate gifts and abilities to the glory of God and to the benefit of others. In the long run, money or recognition or praise has little to do with it. It gives temporary satisfaction, but in the long run, God's grace and faith in the land owner will be your reward. A second problem with the disgruntled workers in the parable is that they lacked a sense of gratitude. How often we are thankless? We forget to say thank you. Can you remember how grateful you were when you got a call or a letter offering you a job? Well, I've got a job. Once you're in the job for a while and the new wears off, isn't that when we begin to complain and find fault? God forbid I do that. Those who are grateful to be employed have little to complain about. When gratitude gives way to routine, then we become disgruntled and begrudge those who seem to have it better. So always maintain an attitude of gratitude. That determines your altitude. Something else about gratitude, it keeps you humble. When you stop to consider those less fortunate, you know the old adage, Lord, keep me humble, lest I forget myself. God reigns in our hearts. We're brought into community with each other, and we experience the fullness of life, not as compensation, but as a gift of grace. He said he would pay one denarius for the work, and I'll point out that a denarius was a coin that was worth quite a bit of money. It was as much money as a man could pay to take care of his family, himself and his family, for a day. So, God's grace was sufficient. It was sufficient because for that day, give us this day our daily bread, it was enough to care for himself and his family. Now, in the Bible and or English dictionary, there are so many words. Words are combinations and can be used over and over again. And whatever, whenever we use these words, we tend to be generous in our words. And so God is generous because the Bible is the word of God, or the words of God. He loves all of us. He is generous with his love. He is generous with his words. He loves each and every one, and is not given because of the amount of work we do. Think of the idea in this way, and think of all the words we can read every single day and cherish in our hearts. So God then has an unending supply of grace for us and words for us. He is also very generous, always generous. And that is something that we need to cultivate within ourselves. Spirit of generosity, always giving, giving. As our Heavenly Father gives us, we give out. Gives us, we give out. It's an unending supply. But, and that is a sense of fairness. But it isn't only about fairness. It is also about God's generosity. He said, "Are you jealous because I am generous?" That leads us on to kindness and thankfulness and things like that. It extends to everyone. It can lead from condemnation to kindness. It is the spring and source of what we do. Where envy, on the other hand, shuts our eyes, as it does from time to time, so we must listen to our hearts. Kindness and thankfulness offer the way to new sight. They enable us to open our eyes, to realize that there is no, but only we, no, mine, but only ours. God gives bountifully. Then there is justice. God's justice is that everyone got to work, and everyone was given an essential earning. The iniquity of their varying hours was offset by the iniquity of their varying strengths and abilities. And this is God's justice. Not that we get what we deserve, but that we get what we need. There's a difference. We do not get what we deserve. We often say that, oh, I got what I deserve, be it in a good way or a bad way. We get what we need. And God is the best one to settle with what is our need. Envy is blind, it is self-inflicted blindness. And the story, the labor management was in dispute, but it seems that the vineyard owner paid his whole crew, a full day's wage, what they needed. It is not for others to judge, or even ourselves to judge. Just accept it. It's God's generosity, God's grace, God's loving kindness. All the workers received justice, not man's justice, but God's. Justice, therefore, arises out of a sense of community as well, in which we see the 11th hour workers as our brothers and sisters, whose needs are every bit as important as our own. Next time you get bent out of shape when someone else gets more than he or she you think deserves, what does it say about your relationship with this person? We are all human and we feel like this at times. But always remember, God is not unfair. And maybe with time, you will understand why such and such a thing happened or why you were treated in such and such a way. We are human, not God. Even so, let's trust God to be just in spite of our humanness, so that when the day comes, when we are caught short, as one day it surely will, there'll be grace for us as well. Again, the story of the workers in the vineyard is about forgiveness. When God forgives our sins, he forgives them all. A brand new Christian is as welcome to God as the person who has known God a long, long, long time. You say, but that's not fair. These last 50 years of my life, I've been serving God and, you know, forsaking all the... The point in this parable is God rewards all who come to him. Come to him in sincerity and with a grateful heart, and he will give you your just wage. He forgives, amen. He forgives all those sins which you ask him to forgive. Some only we know of. But we can always go to God, ask his forgiveness, and be assured that he will forgive us. I have here finally, but I know it's not finally because I have other things. But I'll be very brief. So it's about relationship. It's about thankfulness. It's about kindness. It's about God's grace. It is about an attitude of gratitude. We must practice thankfulness to God. Thank God not only for what is rich and rare, but also for what is plain and ordinary. You will find that glory flashes in every place that God leaves no day or hour unvisited. Practice thanking God. And the scarcity assumption will not make sense. You will recognize it as a lie. You become proficient in thankfulness and you experience abundance. It is not the world that will change, but that your eyes will open. You will look at everything differently. The owner of the vineyard probably realized that those first men couldn't get the job done by themselves. He went back and hired more people. Later he went back again. That time he asked, why are you standing, doing nothing? We're supposed to be employed in his vineyard. The men answered, because no one has hired us. So he hired them. And a short time before the end of the day, he went back and still hired more people. Can't you see? It's unending. Everybody is welcome. And it is our job, once we are in, to invite others in. So if it's at the last moment, if it's on their deathbed, if it's like the thief next to Jesus on the cross, they will come in. That is what God's kingdom is all about. That is the good news. Christ died for all. He rose. And he ascended to heaven. He's preparing a place for everyone. He's not slow respecting his promise of coming back. But he is patient because he does not want anyone to be destroyed. It indicates, marking, that some will be destroyed. But he does not want it. That's not his wish. So please, my brothers and sisters, not only yourselves, look after yourselves, but your fellow men as well. God's grace. Because this lesson is very ironical. And when it comes to experiencing God's grace, those who grasp it, especially early in life, the younger ones, are indeed the most fortunate. How much greater a gift to live a life with and through Christ, filled with hope and love from a very young age, than to find Christ only on one's deathbed after a lifetime of loneliness and despair. These are hard lessons to learn, aren't they? And they are impossible lessons without faith. We must have faith in God's word. That parable is not to be put on the shelf. It is there for a reason. You see how many things we have drawn from that simple passage. God cares. He cares about a life lived in faith, not a life filled with achievement, although that is good in itself. Faith in God is the important thing. So, my friends, today's gospel reading, the parable of the laborers in the vineyard, gives us yet another difficult message. He tells us in this parable that our reward as Christians is solely dependent on the grace of God. Jesus likens the kingdom of heaven to a landowner who ignores the rules when he hands out wages at the end of the day. He does not base the amount he pays each worker on how many hours they work. He gives everyone the same wage, whether they work 12 hours, 1 hour, or whatever it may be. Where is the fairness here? Jesus turns everything upside down. Those who begin to work late in the day last get as much money as those who started at dawn first. The landowner represents God's grace. We all have an equal share. Everyone gets the same amount. It doesn't matter who you are, where you are, or where you started. But start. Enter the race. Once you place the faith in God, just as Jesus placed his faith in God, your share of God's grace is equal to anyone else's share of grace. Let us not make comparisons and think that everything is right for them. We must not be envious of others. We must remember the generosity of God's love. Remember that it's offered to everyone, and we need to invite others. We need to see God's generosity everywhere in the world. Can think of examples, maybe all during the day you can think. Think about the beauty of sunrise. What a lovely day we have today, like the Caribbean. How the colors spread across the sky when you wake in the morning, again and again and again. And at the close of day, the sunset colors the sky. Think of all the birds and animals, the fish in the vast oceans, spectacular mountains. Think of tiny wildflowers that grow in the fields, not to mention the ones that are cared for by those green fingers. The beautiful mosses we find on the rocks. Think of the people who love you and care for you. Think of your friends. Gifts from God because of his grace. You may not have a penny in your pocket, but you have a friend That's a greater blessing, my friends, greater blessing. So, let us conclude as time is going swiftly by. Jesus uses the story of the landowner and the workers to teach us to be glad for the good fortune and generosity of others. We must always remember to give thanks for this generosity, for his love, which is rich and overflowing, and is offered to each one of us. Let us have closing prayer. Generous God, you come to us again and again. No matter how late it is in the day or in our lives, calling us, gathering us, giving us good work to do, daily bread and boundless grace. Increase in us a generous spirit so that we may do your work with joy alongside others whom you also love. We celebrate salvation, not only in our lives, but also in the lives of other people. Even those we had not imagined would be included in the kingdom you are bringing. Align us with your ways and help us receive your gifts of justice and mercy as good news. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Next song, which is Blessed Assurance, which is one of my favorites, by the way. So I would like you to do it figure. Although we cannot sing because of our social distancing, etc. I just wanted to do one thing before the song, and I'm being very generous here. I want to invite Reverend Cornelius up. A gift. I don't know if Mrs. Henry would like to come as well. Okay. And I present this gift to you and the something inside as well, to the congregation, and hopefully we might get it framed or something and later have it as our guide. Because in this parish we have lots of roads and we can all witness to and bear the light of God.
Upside down.
That's our parish, though.
Yes, and the roads and streets in our parish. Thank you. Thank you very much.
I have the good pleasure of celebrating. And there's something else. What's that? I thought I had something else inside. Yeah. Okay. It's a picture of our beautiful church. I presented one before, but this is bigger.
All right, I'll keep this.
Okay. All right. Right. Can we have our next song then, please? fills us with his love. We believe in God, the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high.
We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen. We now have our prayers or intercessions by Milton.
Hello. Good morning. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we are thankful for this day. We look at the world, its very presence had to be created by you, Lord of all creation. It is a privilege to be here, to worship you in spirit and in truth. You have made mankind into your likeness and image. This wasn't an accident. Thank you, Father. You have created mankind out of your love for all. Father, you have reminded us that man shall not live by bread alone. Your words are very much needed in our lives for us to live in peace and love. The world pandemic with the coronavirus, we continue to pray for this situation, that a vaccine or some form of treatment can be found. Public Health England, along with doctors, nurses, and care homes, we are very grateful and thankful for the care they give. As the autumn weather approaches, the flu season is upon us. We continue to pray for our elderly in care homes and in general, anyone with underlying health issue. Unfortunately, the northeast of our country have gone into lockdown due to an increase in the infection rate of this virus. Schools have reopened, many of the children and the teachers have returned to classrooms. We pray, Father, the necessary adjustments can be made to the school environment to make it safe for the teachers and students. Supermarkets and shops have reopened and customers are slowly returning to our high streets. We pray, Father, that we continue to come through these difficult times. Churches are slowly returning with their doors open and Christians are able to worship in the house of the Lord. The new social distancing have allowed us to come together along with the wearing of our face masks. We continue to pray for all our church and all of our members. Those who are vulnerable and are sick, we pray they'll continue to get better. We pray for our Vicar Cornelius and his family. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers.
So we are going to have our share of peace. Thank you. Thank you very much, Milton. Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet together in his name and we share his peace. Peace of the Lord be always with you.
And
so let's share the peace with one another and just say hello, turn around. You don't need to get out your seat, you don't need to move. However, if you do have an offering, you put it in the offering plate at the back, and that's going to be brought up in a moment or so. Aaron is going to play a song, and while we do that, you just stretch your leg and
Praise the Lord.
So let's pray together our offertory prayer. Gracious God, for all you have given us, all you will give us, and all you give us here and now, we offer you our thanks and praise. Bless us as we seek to obey your word in giving back to you what you have given to us in gratitude for your love and grace. In the name of Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord is here.
The Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
And lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right. It is our duty and our joy to give you thanks, Holy Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And now we give you thanks because you reveal the glory of your eternal fellowship of love with your Son and with the Holy Spirit, three persons equal in majesty, undivided in splendor, yet one God, ever to be worshipped and adored. Hear us, Heavenly Father, through Christ, your Son, our Lord, and grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us his body and his blood. Who on the same night that he was betrayed took bread, he gave you thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup and he gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Therefore, Father, proclaiming his saving death and his glorious resurrection, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate with this bread and this cup, his one perfect sacrifice. Accept through him, our great high priest, this our sacrifice of thanks and praise. And grant that we who eat this bread and drink this cup may be renewed by your Spirit.
and grow into his likeness. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom, and with whom, and in whom, all glory and honor be yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
As Jesus taught us to call God our Father, so in faith and trust we pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body,
because we all share in one bread. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world,
have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world,
have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world,
have mercy on us.
So we receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for us, and we eat and drink in remembrance that Jesus died for us, and we feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Amen.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. Coming, do come to the far end of the rail, and do come one by one, and I will give you the bread. It's a bread only, of course.
Thank you.
Deserve that grace. But he gives it to us anyway. And so this table of grace, this table of mercy, we bring all our concerns to our gracious and merciful God. We come to him for grace. We come to him to ask for his help as we journey in this life. So we bring before our God, our gracious God, our suffering, our problems, our concerns, our desires, all that's on our hearts. At the table of God's grace, we are promised absolution. We are promised forgiveness. We are promised strength for the journey. And so we bring ourselves, Lord. We bring our families. We bring our church. We bring our world. And we ask for your mercy. We ask for your grace. And so, Lord, we ask that you have mercy on those who are sick, those who are suffering in mind or in body. We bring them to you at this table of grace. We ask, Lord, that you'll hear us as we bring to you those who are bereaved, especially those we know recently lost loved ones in our community. We bring them to you. We ask for your grace to strengthen them during this time of sorrow. Time of mourning. We pray, Lord, that you will strengthen them by that all-sufficient grace today, as they continue their journey with you. Give them grace for the journey. Remember especially this week as we gather to say farewell to our brother Akko. We pray for Chichi and all the family here and in Nigeria, that you will be with them during this difficult time of saying goodbye. We pray, Lord, that you will remind us of the hope we have in Christ, that because Jesus is alive, we will see our loved ones again. We'll see Akko again. We'll see Molu again. And all those who have gone before us. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Keep, O Lord, your church with your perpetual mercy. And because without you, our human frailty cannot but
fall. Keep us ever by your help from all things hurtful, and lead us to all things that are profitable for our salvation, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let's say together our prayer of thanks. Almighty Father, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. May we who share his body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We who the Spirit lights give light to the world. Help us to continue in faithful witness to your word, so that we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. Notices before we have our final hymn and say farewell for this morning. As you've heard in my prayers, and is on the notice sheet number 13, Chichi and the family are finally going to repatriate our brother's body back to Nigeria the end of this week, I think, or beginning of next. So we are asked to be there if you would like to come and say farewell to our brother Akko on Friday evening, on the 25th of September at 5 p.m. at Cribb's Funeral Home in Beckton. We're putting together a little service, half an hour of service of reading. There'll be no singing, but I do want to sing at least or play Akko's favorite song. Does anybody know what that is? Akko's favorite hymn. Whenever we have something here, baptism or whatever, we would ask, do you know what it is, Jeff? What is it? Well, you know what it is? Oh, it is Because He Lives. I show your face too much. I do want to play that. I hope Cribs allow me to at least play it on my phone or something. I don't know. We'll see how it goes. But it will be a little service, as I said, not more than half an hour, for us to say goodbye properly to our brother Akko as the body goes off to Nigeria. So that's Friday. Put that in your diary if you can make it. Next Sunday, as I said, we want to celebrate our harvest. Things are different, of course, we know that. So we will see if we can come together as a group, some minds thinking, creative minds. I'm no good at creativity, but I'm sure there are some creative people over there looking at me. And so if we can somehow make a creative service next year, that is, with keeping with all the rules and all the regulations, I'm sure we can do something. So let's see what our minds come up with this spirit and our own thinking can. This week, of course, as you know, I've been pushing CCS, the Course in Christian Studies. CCS starts on Wednesday evening. I'm the tutor for this side of the program, of the course. If anybody wants to join us, it's not too late, of course. The details, you can email Diane. I think she was on holiday, but I'm pretty sure she should be back by tomorrow to get things ready for Wednesday evening. CCS is an amazing course. It's a course in the Christian Studies. It follows I'll say a little bit about it, and it follows the church, the school year. So it goes 6 weeks, and then half term, and then 6 weeks, exactly like the school year. And it's three terms in 1 year, and it's 2 years. But don't let 2 years put you off, it goes like that, quickly. And the first, for the first 5 weeks, actually, for the first 5 weeks, we're looking at theology. What is theology? Why do we study theology? Why do we study scripture and God and so on? And then the second half of the first term, leading up to Christmas, we start looking at the Old Testament and what the Old Testament means, and what can we learn about from the Old Testament as Christians. And it's actually just 6 weeks on the Old Testament. So it is surely not as in-depth as I would like, but it's what I call stepping in with your toes in the
theological water of Scripture and the church. If you are interested, follow the guidelines on the Zoom. We are meeting on Zoom, and that's the only thing with this year. Normally we meet at St. John's Church in Stratford. That's where the center is, that's where I would be normally teaching. But of course, with all that's going on, the headquarters of CCS, that is in Chelmsford Diocese, taken the decision that all the courses will be meeting on Zoom until at least December, until at least Christmas. And then we'll see what happens, regulations and so forth. Maybe we can go back to meeting face-to-face, but in January. But at the moment, it's a Zoom meet. So if you're not a Zoom person, sorry, that's where we start. So you might want to pick it up next year when we are when we're meeting face-to-face again, hopefully. Other things, do keep in mind the other things, especially our Operation Christmas Child. I don't want us to forget these things. We don't want these things to suffer despite the differences and so forth, and the abnormality of, or the new normal, I prefer, the new normal that we have here. We want to maintain some of these things going forward. So our Operation Christmas Child, do remember the shoeboxes, and Georgina is busy. Yes, Georgina is busy wrapping the boxes. So if you can get shoe boxes, that'd be great. And also, of course, we're going to put the list out so that people can start, and the boxes, so you can start bringing in the things that we put in the boxes, for the shoe boxes. All right, I think that's it for that. Birthdays, I have Comfort. Is it Comfort's birthday this week? Yes, Wednesday. Hey, it's a Comfort birthday Wednesday. Anybody else this week? Jocelyn, is it your birthday this week as well? Tuesday? 20? Oh, yesterday. Hey. So yes to Jocelyn. Yes, Andy.
July.
Yeah, yours is gone. All right, we still sing happy birthday to you. That's fine. Yes? Anybody else? Birthdays? All right, so we have three. One very belated one, and two others. Yes, Georgia? Amen. So we give God thanks. All right, so let's sing happy birthday to these guys, and then we pray. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
Let's pray.
Father, we thank you for these young children who are celebrating birthdays. Thank you for those who have celebrated their birthday, like Andy, and those who are celebrating this week and yesterday. We pray for your grace, it's all sufficient grace, upon them this special time in their lives. And we ask, Lord, that you give them a special blessing of your presence, of your grace, of your power. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
All right. Any anniversaries? Yes, no? No anniversaries this week. All right. And Michael is going back. Michael is going back this week, yes? Going back to university this week. So I want to pray for you. Anybody else? No, that's it. Because Rihanna went last week, didn't she? So yes.
Yesterday.
Yesterday? Oh, yesterday. Okay. So all right. So let's pray for Michael and Rihanna, of course, and anyone else who are at university. You're Rihanna as well. No. Who?
Shanai.
Oh. University as well. Amen. So let's pray. Father, we thank you for these your children, Shanai and Michael and Rihanna, who are going to university this time of year. We are praying especially, Lord, for our university students and for all our students, children are going to school during this very, very difficult time. We pray that you will protect them from COVID virus. And Lord, we pray for protection from everything that's evil in our world, for our young people. We pray that you will be a shield around their mind. Let them wear the helmet of salvation to protect their minds from all the ungodly teaching that they will endure. We pray that you'll protect their hearts. We pray that you'll protect their bodies from sickness and disease. And so, Lord, we entrust these our young people to you. And we ask that you will empower them to excel in the studies that they have set their hearts to, and at the same time to excel in all that is good and righteous in your sight. We ask this in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. All right, so let's have a final hymn, I think. Yes. And guys, let's just have a little huddle afterwards, a talk about next week if we can, just to see what we can do. Final Our Father, we thank you for this amazing grace that you have lavished upon us despite ourselves. And so as we go, Lord, we ask that you'll go with us, empowering us by this awesome, amazing grace, that we will trust, rely in this grace, your amazing generosity to us sinners who do not deserve it. May we go reflecting, trusting in this grace, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. And so may God be with you in your going out and your coming in. May God be with you in your work and in your leisure. May God be with you in life's hills and in its valleys. May God be with you in company and solitude. May God be with you in all your pilgrimage and at its end. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you and all you love today, this week, and forever and ever. Amen. And so go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.
Amen. Amen.